Mary Ting is a visual artist who has been working over 30 years of creating and exhibiting her work. Her solo exhibitions include Witch, Whore, Widow at Metaphor Contemporary, excerpts from The Dysfunctional Forest at Kentler International, and Insomnia Stories at the Lambent Foundation. Her recent social practice projects include Daffodil Ashes on Grief and Art with the Rubin Museum of Art, and Compassion for the Animals Great and Small on Wildlife Trafficking at the Chinese American Arts Council. Ting is a recipient of many, many awards. I don't think I'm going to read all of them. She's a two-time New York Foundation for the Arts Fellow, a Lambent Foundation Fellow. She has been an artist in residence at the McDowell Colony, Malay Colony, Lower East Side Print Shop, in addition to the upcoming 2016 Joan Mitchell Center, New Orleans, and LMCC in process residency. From 1995 to 1998, she worked at UNICEF, Beijing, organizing 12 photography exhibitions on China's social problems, and she also conducted field research in the region of the Yellow River Plateau. Mary Ting teaches at John Jay College in the Studio Art Department and the Sustainability and Environmental Justice Program. She has a BFA from Parsons School of Design, New York City, an advanced degree in folk art research from the Central Academy of Fine Art, Beijing, and an MFA from the Vermont College of Fine Art. She is also an avid gardener and writer. Thanks for coming out today. It's a beautiful evening, and I'm sure we're going to have a beautiful time. Welcome, Mary.
Thank you. Okay. Well, thank you. First, I want to thank Russell and Ari, Joyce Moy, Anthony for inviting me. And I think this talk is really timely for me. There are so many issues that have been percolating for several years now, and I feel like it was just perfect timing that it just kind of landed this way, that I had this opportunity to give this talk. Some of you might have been on my mailing list, and I said, please come to this one, it's an important one. So I just feel like, versus your standard artist talk, this one incorporates a lot more. It's a lot more layered. A lot more revealing, and I think after a while it's really just about life and being here. So I have one thing to ask of you, aside from my heartfelt thanks for coming and being supportive, is that if you could hold any questions to the end, because I'm just going to go through really a lot of storytelling, and I just want to be able to go through it first, and if you can just hold off and ask me at the end, right? So, okay, without further ado, this is Grief, Guanyin, and the Elephants. Okay, so this is dedicated to my mother, who passed away in 2010. I grew up in a house of wonders, with cat, fish, rescued baby animals, even pet shrimp and fiddler crabs, and a lush botanical garden. And in that house, I played a game of look, opening the cabinet doors, pulling out the ceramic dishes, staring at the patterns one by one, taking the lids off brocade boxes, marveling at the carvings inside carvings, and my mother's magical dried Linzer mushroom from her Jinling Girls College, the 1947 dragonfly wing pressed between her Chinese biology books. But it was my mother who taught me how to look, to see the skeletalized leaves on the ground, to note the date that the red-winged blackbird returned. She was the keeper of the wonder cabinet, the gardener, and the creator of everything in our house, from our clothing to the furniture. To me, my mother was a heron dressed in a Chinese qipao. And I was a cat following her about the house, watching to see what she was doing, never letting her out of my sight. So all the dresses that my mother is wearing, she made, and she was incredibly resourceful when she came to New York. She took her her Chinese dress and she ripped all the stitches and she made a pattern, and she traced the pattern and then she put it all back together again. And that's how she learned to sew. So she wasn't taught, and there was no pattern. And that pattern existed all the way till she was 75, and she had a hump. So at that point, you can't wear a qipao anymore. And I recently found the pattern. She just would expand it inches. So, okay. So it was her mustard seed manual, her mustard seed garden painting manual that she purchased on the streets of Nanjing. That was my earliest encounter with art and my entrance to the world of Chinese woodblock print and a distinct way of seeing, drawing, and looking at the natural world. I flipped the pages and stared at the books. There were volumes of them, and I looked at them over and over again. And yes, I colored in them. This is an authentic woodblock edition. So, and it was one morning that I woke up, and it felt like from the living room floor that this screen rose up. And here it was, a painted cardboard screen of these four birds. And it was for the Emperor's Nightingale production. And for me, the screen disappeared as quickly as it appeared. So later that day, it was gone. And I almost thought it was a dream because there was no proof of it. And yes, I found this photo and I scanned it and sent it to my sister. And she's like, oh, I'm so glad you found it. Because we didn't know if we made it up or not. Because it all happened in our sleep. So, and with the seasons, there was always a changing parade of flowers in her garden. However, people would often ask, so, where did you grow up? And what language did you speak in your house? Well, to that, I would answer, well, in suburban Long Island in the 1960s. But then again, I would also think to myself, the house was situated in suburban Long Island, but it was also along the bloody banks of the Nanjing River of 1937. And the dirt floors of my father's house in Jiangxi and the cane whip and the echoes of Beijing during the Gang of Four. As to the language, well, English and Shanghainese, but the real language that was spoken throughout the 12 rooms of that house was non-verbal. It was a language of whimpers and silence. So my mother's family, the Pan family, this is in Shanghai, so they had a house in Shanghai and in Nanjing. And no, this isn't all family members. It's actually the entire household and all the people who worked for my grandfather. So he is sitting down roughly in the center with his, with my grandmother. And you know, I really don't know if all the children are there or not. I remember my mom showing me this picture and saying, isn't it totally absurd, all these people? So it was during the Japanese occupation that the Japanese general took over the house and the water lily pond was used as his bath. And I have been to this house. It's now a government agency. So this is the lineup of the six Pan family children, and my mom is the second one, and it was convenient that they were in age order and in size order. So my grandfather decided that in order to like to make them stronger as children and as human beings, he wanted them to compete against each other. So yes, he had them compete against each other, and they each had, because my grandfather was never around, he was a general manager and he worked for the Sung family, the Nationalist Party, so he was never around. And so they were taken care of in boarding schools and by their own servant. And the servants would also gang up on the other siblings and help fight for their child. So this was actually quite ruthless and did not encourage any kind of, you know, sibling love, to say the least. And I'm seeing if any of my cousins are here. and they're not. Okay. So I could say that, you know, though all these are now my aunts and uncles, they all did say that my mom was the kindest of all of them. and did not participate. She couldn't fathom how to compete against each other. However, you know, it was during the time of the Japanese occupation, which, as people know, this was really a horrific time in both Nanjing and Shanghai, and they would run from one place to the other. She was only 10 years old, and I don't know the exact details other than one of the servants locked her out of the house while the Japanese soldiers were around, and she was completely traumatized, and she was locked out for 5 hours. So, and the servant refused to allow her in. So she, I think that traumatized her along with many other things that happened at that time period for the rest of her life. She did suffer from what they call night terrors. You know, when you, you know, whimper and scream in the night. So, anyway, so, but you know, at my bedtime and all through my growing up, my mother told me incredible stories of Nanjing, of racing down the hills and having one roller skate, and all the other kids each had one, because you couldn't have too many kids to have two for each. And she told me about the dragon carved columns in Jinling University. So it was always a combination of something incredible and wonderful, and how after the war, all the animals, the pets that were from all these different families all appeared at their house. So at every staircase, there was a different animal. There was a dog, there was a rabbit, there was a greyhound, there was a Great Dane, there were cats, and they all got along. So there were all these incredible stories, and there were the really horrific ones too. And for me as a child, those were my bedtime stories, and it all blurred together. So this is my father's family. So my father was born in Jiangxi, and his father is in the middle there, and he is the smallest one to the right. And so that again is my grandfather, Ding Koin. He had numerous names. He would always constantly get in trouble and then come up with a new name. And that, they grew up together, and they're very close in age, and they were all in the same household, and that's granduncle Rao Yutai. Now, the two of them passed their exams, but Rao Yutai went on to the University of Michigan and then later on to Princeton to do his graduate degree and his PhD. And then he did his postdoc work in Germany. My grandfather, on the other hand, stayed in China, and he got very involved in politics and was a student leader in the revolution against the Manchurians. As a revolutionary leader at that time period, once the revolution was won, he was made an automatic member of the Nationalist Party. And at that time, he was also close friends with various warlords. I mean, that was the time period. And then the warlords had also been helping to fight with the nationalists. So he had gone back to academic regular life and was trying to no longer be a part of politics. But he was summoned by Chiang Kai-shek to go into the mountains of Jiangxi to talk to his warlord friend and to convince him to bring his followers, which were 3,000 to 4,000, and they were all at that time working as farmers, to bring them into Guangzhou and to talk to Chiang Kai-shek about becoming part of the Nationalist Army. So he did that. He went there and he brought his friend back. There have been discrepancies about his friend's name. My dad is 90, so any rate, and he brought with him 300 bodyguards, because you don't just walk into this situation without your bodyguards. He didn't bring the whole army, but he brought 300 bodyguards. And Chiang Kai-shek was initially lukewarm, wasn't particularly interested. And then the next day, it was Mao Zedong. And you have to realize at that time period, everyone knew each other. And everyone at that time were friends. So Mao asked him, both my grandfather and the warlord, so, you know, where is your loyalty? What do you think of Karl Marx? And to that, the warlord answered, I don't care about Karl Marx, he's a foreigner. My loyalty is to Confucius. Okay, so with that, we knew that there was no way, from Mao's point of view, that he could be converted. He couldn't become a communist. So there would be no use for him. So that 300 bodyguards were ambushed, and they fought, but they were killed by the Nationalist Army. So you see how tricky things are at that time period. And then my grandfather and the warlord were put in jail as traitors. So they were put in jail for a year, and that was the year that my father was born. So that's 1925. And my father has always been very particular about, like, if someone's not around and you do anything to their objects or their belongings, and he'll get all upset. And I never understood why. And one day he finally, when I was like in my 20s, he explained, he's like, well, you know, your grandfather, they used to periodically take all his belongings and say they were going to shoot him today, and they were going to throw away his belongings. So they did that very often, just to keep him on edge. So for a year, he was kept in jail. And then later, he was freed. Both of them were freed. And there was like, sorry, mistake. Okay. So at that time, you understand from the warlord's army, from his 3,000 followers in the mountains of Jiangxi, from their point of view, they understood it as the Nationalist Party put them in jail. So they became communist and became the Communist Army. So everyone knows that the communist stronghold began in Jiangxi in the mountains. So that's actually the story behind that. And so my grandfather returned to, once again, to academic life. And he vowed to never go back into politics. And that was something that he really enforced upon his kids, that they could not enter politics because you never could trust anyone. So these are the three brothers. That's my dad, all the way the shortest one, to the right, and once again in size order as it works. So here are the three brothers, and their names are actually related to where they were born. Okay, so it's all a river in the area that they were born. So they were all quite smart, but my father, being him, he was the last, so he didn't go to school. The first one goes to school, and he was taught along with the second one by my grandfather's students. So my dad says, well, he had a lead in that way, because he was the same level as the second one, even though he's younger. So as it happened, he was very, very smart. And later they moved to Shanghai. And it's the first one in a Chinese family that's going to always have the opportunity. And so they wanted the oldest son to take the national exams to go abroad. Okay, so all the pressure was on the eldest. And my dad, secretly, they asked him to go get the forms, and he took one for himself. He also decided he was going to take the exams. And he decided, he was already in college at that time in Jiao Tong University in Shanghai in mechanical engineering. And he thought, there's so much competition in mechanical engineering. Every Chinese male is in mechanical engineering. Why don't I take a different topic? So he got every book in the library on textile engineering, read them, and went and took the exam in textile. As it turns out, he passed. He scored really high. At that time, the people giving the exam did not know my dad's political allegiance, and they decided let's change his scores, and they flunked him on Chinese and on English. But his scores were so high in the other subject matters, he still landed a full scholarship to Harvard in textile engineering, which he hated. So my dad actually found out because he met the person who changed his scores, and it's like Chinese people can be, my dad wasn't even mad. He just went, how did that happen? How did I score so low in Chinese? He said, English I could see, but Chinese? And they're like, oh no, we changed those scores. and they're like, oh, okay. So anyway, so my dad goes to Harvard, and he manages to do his master's degree in textile engineering in 1 year. and then get another scholarship to MIT and do a master's degree in mechanical engineering, the thing he wanted to study, and that was 1 year or so. And this is a very frustrating thing for all his children. And then he went on to do another one-year degree, a one-year PhD in aeronautical engineering at NYU. So when I found this out, I was in college, and I was like, Dad, how did you do that? That's 3 degrees and 3 topics in 3 years. And he's like, I didn't talk to anyone. And I believe that, because he was also working full time and married. So he didn't really talk to us. So I think that's true. And he was, you know, he had extreme work ethic. He was also very conscious of the politics of China. And he was afraid what might happen, so he kept on getting scholarships and kept on going to school. The eldest brother eventually did go abroad, and he got a scholarship to University of Michigan, and then he did his PhD in Canada, and he became a nuclear physicist. Did his postdoc in Germany, and if not for the Nazis, would never have gone back. He was in Canada, and then he went back. He was called back. They're like, you have to come back. You're engaged. We want you back here. So the story behind that is that the ambassador of the U.S., whose name is Husi, who's also a family friend, wrote the letter that allowed him to go to Canada. And from Canada, you could get your visa to China. You couldn't go from the U.S. At this point, the Cold War has set in, the doors are closed. So my father doesn't see his family for 30 plus years. The oldest son goes back. Okay, he's called back. So this is my dad as a young man. So there's a 30-year gap, and during this time period, you know, that's why I say that there is a lot of sadness and a lot of silence. You know, during that time period, I do remember that we were wrapping packages of oil and cotton and towels because we were really worried. You think about this is the time period of the Great Famine. We also, there was no contact with the family anymore. All the letters weren't going through or they were open. The letters coming back were clearly not from family members. So no one knew what was going on, and we're all busy making these parcels, and you know, all the basic needs were being sent back. Of course, none of them ever reached the family, and if they did, they would have gotten in trouble for having overseas relatives. Actually, I later found out that the photos that were sent, you know, hi, I had a baby, and all those kinds of things, were either they all burned them because they didn't want to be found with such photos, and then some of them actually had been put in the streets of Beijing as proof of foreign relatives. So that could be, that's part of the purges. So my dad, in this is actually not his first trip, but there's no photo from the first trip, was in 78, so we're talking about the end of the Cultural Revolution. He actually manages to go back sort of in this way that he was in Tokyo. Doing a conference, and he got the Canadian government to approve a visa for him to go to China, you know, from Tokyo. And that was actually, you know, once he's in China, the Chinese were like, oh my God, he's, you know, this is a problem. Because my uncle, the one that you had seen in that earlier photo, he became a very important person in the world of physics when he went back, and he had passed away. And all the news coming out was like, oh, he died of a heart attack. Oh, he had colon cancer. Oh, he had lung cancer. And so they were all conflicting. So no one knew what was the real story. And this is a man who was the Dean of Academy of Sciences in Beidai. He had started the physics department in Fudan. In Shanghai. He had founded the physics department in Beijing University. So he was very important. And his favorite student, you know, in Chinese it's all about the legacies. His favorite student was Dr. Wu Daiyo, Wudayo is renowned in Taiwan. And, you know, so anyway, so there was all this concern because they didn't want my dad to find out what had happened. Also, when my dad went back, you know, half the family members are not there anymore. So there's a lot of unanswered questions. So originally, they just let him sit in the hotel. And eventually, there was a young person in the hotel, and my dad's getting really frustrated. They, you know, they won't let him see his family member. And this young person, luckily it was a young person, not one of the supervisors, who said, "Oh, why don't you just write a letter?" And so he did, within Beijing. And sure enough, they're like, "You'll get there one day." And so this letter wasn't intercepted because it was within Beijing. And sure enough, my aunt gets it. It's like, he's here? And so then she goes to her work unit and she's like, "My uncle's here." So so now they're stuck. They have to like let them meet. So that was how, you know, the family members got to meet the first time. And then it was still, no one would dare to tell my dad any of the true stories. And eventually he does see his mom. That's the last time he sees his mom, and she blurts out everything. So this is a later trip. So that was 78. This is 81. And at this point, he is actually given a welcome. And this is at the, you know, the Great Hall, Renming Dahui Tang. So this is at the, and I actually saw these images on TV when I was in the U.S. So this is like, I remember like looking and thinking, "Oh my God, that's Dad!" And look at those weird sofas. They're so big with those, you know, lace cloths and things like that. And so this is the Vice Premier of Science Education. This is after a 30-year separation. And then he goes on in 1981 to lecture in Shanghai and in Beijing, and he actually even carried students, and these students became very, very important later in China. He carried four students in Shanghai and four students in Beijing, all people part of the Academy of Sciences. So my dad, but for me, as a child at that time, I felt like I didn't really know this man. And it was actually at the show for the Asian Art Institute that Bob Lee is the director of, that I was asked to do a piece about fathers. And I really felt like I didn't know very much about my father. But when he was in China over that time period, he was writing me letters. And that was the first time of this different kind of communication. And most of the letters were about food. They were about the price of chicken, the price of beef, all those types of things. And I started to realize that for my dad, and probably for many men, especially Chinese men, the expression of love came through food, right? So I made this container, and on the outside is the airmail envelopes. On the inside is all these like wrappings and, you know, the foils from candy wrappers and things like that. And the bottom was a biography. And I read the biography and I didn't know any of this information in that biography. And it was from the, it was his 60th birthday, and the Journal of Fluid Dynamics dedicated that issue to him. So various students and colleagues each wrote papers in his honor. That's where I started to first learn some other information about my father from that angle. And then I spoke about how there was so much silence in this household, and so much that was unspoken but painfully felt. So at that time I made a piece that was called Silent Years. And I had seen paper cuts since I was a little kid, and my mom taught all the kids on the block how to make paper cuts and snowflakes. I had seen some that had come back from communist China. Those were the really kind of more rigid, commercially made ones. So I decided, oh, let's do that for a stage set. Because later on we toured this production, and we went to Toronto, and I could roll it up and put it in a tube and go across the border. So these are cranes, and that's me. It's been Wala Shambra. So this is a 45-minute dance piece. We made the text, the sound, we all performed in it. The other lead choreographer was David Rousseff of UCLA World Cultures. We also went to Toronto with it. And I also made this piece is actually in the Chinese traditional format. It's like pre-books when people gave deeds and messages in a wooden format. And actually I decided to take that ancient format and inside I put the text of what's going on in a woman's mind as she's being raped. So it's like the inner layers. So I decided to appropriate this, you know, the deed format. So it's called I Can Count No More. This is called Waiting. This is Pile of Scars. This is called Mourning. And Wounded. You know, vestiges. She carries her wounds in her purse. You know, growing up, I remember being so in awe of my mom's pocketbook. Because in the pocketbook is like, you know, everything important to a female. And in those days, we called it a pocketbook, too. And so I decided that, you know, there's so much in a pocketbook. And in a way, my mom carried all these sort of horrors in her. And then in essence, as a child, she passes it to you. So you end up carrying the purse for her. So I made this purse, and there's even like a little zipper and some organs in it. This is another purse, and it's made of hair and handmade paper, and there's like pins so it pricks you if you were to wear it. That's my mom, that's me, Panda Bear. And that's actually my grandfather in that tiny photograph in Beijing, in front of the Nine Dragon Wall. You know, I really felt that so much of what was in my mom, in so many ways, it kind of, all her stories, it kind of got embedded in me. So this is called Grieving Sights. And so I think long before I even knew what I was grieving about, I had these images. So eventually, I go to China. So in 95 to 98, I was there for 3 years. And one of the first things that my father says to me before I go, he said, okay, well now you have to go to Babaoshan and you have to clean the graves. And if for those who know, I mean, Babaoshan, this is the cemetery of the revolutionary heroes. And most of our family were actually killed by the revolution, by the Cultural Revolution. So it's a great irony, and it's just the reality of China and the flip-flop of history and when you're incriminated and when you're a hero, it just changes back and forth. So, but they really felt that at least, even though the bodies were tossed, at least their name has honor now. And who cares that it's in the Hall of the Revolutionary Heroes? The fact is that their name has been resurrected. So our family paid the fee. You have to pay a fee to be put in that hall. It's a rental fee. So we paid the fees gladly because they felt like at least the name is back. And so I would go to clean the graves. So if you look at the top row, the first one to the left, that's Rao Yutai. And the second one is my grandparents. The third one, we don't know him. And then the fourth one is my uncle. That's the one who is in the photo with my dad. That's the one who went to University of Ohio and went to Canada, the nuclear physicist. So what happened to Rao Yutai, and I'll finish that story, is that for a long time, he was okay. He wasn't purged. He was a dean of the Academy of Sciences. But you remember, at one point, Beida, the president of Beida, a plane came from Taiwan to bring him and the top professors back to Taiwan. They were going to form their version of a Beida in Taiwan. So he was expected to go. And his daughter said to me later, you know, we always had a packed suitcase. But he decided he didn't want to leave China. So they didn't go. They didn't go on that plane. and they stayed in China. And along with four other top professors, they stayed. Well, that would later on lead to their downfall. Because when the Gang of Four came and the purges, they were accused of being nationalist spies for staying and for not leaving. And my granduncle was asked to take the stand to denounce himself, as well as the four other professors, which is something he couldn't do. His daughter, who had grown up in all this turmoil, had been beaten and jailed, and she was in jail at this time. She said she didn't have the strength like the rest of us did. That's what her words were. He was older. He couldn't tolerate, he just couldn't. And so that night, he hung himself. And actually, I think for so many intellectuals at that time, that was your last word. You had your last say. You wouldn't do it. So that is what he did. But of course, that causes an immediate problem for the family. And the body is tossed, the family's money is frozen, everyone's in trouble now. Okay, so, and then years later, of course, things get turned around. He's on the list of, you know, people that this was a mistake. And he's now in Babaoshan. Okay, so there's no ashes, it's just an empty box, but we all go and we clean it. My grandfather, he actually was sick at the time of when they were starting all the purges, and he was already given a letter, which he had to reply for, a letter accused with accusations, and he had already prepared a submission, and he died. So he was free of all that turmoil, and he actually died of natural causes. So they were actually going to accuse him certainly as a nationalist, even though, really, what was he, a nationalist? But because he died, he was actually given a national funeral. And at that national funeral, we have the Chinese newspaper from it was saved for us. Zhou Enlai appeared, the warlord, back from years ago, appeared too as well. And that newspaper was precious. It was saved because years later, when the Gang of Four was at their height and they were running up the stairs in my grandmother's apartment and he was dead, she had plastered it on the door to protect the family. Her husband died of with a national funeral, with a parade, so they couldn't touch her. So he's in Babaoshan. And then all the way to the right, that's my uncle. Because my uncle went back and he was a nuclear physicist, initially he was welcomed. Later on, of course, he was sent to labor. I think he was forever, you know, kind of in turmoil and not able to work. And that was the greatest frustration. All these men, that's like life is work. My dad has written over 100 papers. They're just like, that's all they do, you know, 7 days a week. So to not be able to work was the greatest frustration. And his sons, they all feel that he died indirectly of the Cultural Revolution. So he died of the stress and the heartbreak. That's something I do every time I go to Beijing. It's one of the first things that I do, just to take care of duties. It's grandfather, grandmother, uncle. Okay, so this is one of these rare times when I'm in Beijing and my father is in Beijing. And the person all the way to the left, that is Rao Weizi. She is the stepdaughter of Rao Yutai, basically the founder of modern physics in China. And my very first trip to Babaoshan, she came with me. You need a special pass to get into that cemetery. You have to prove that you're a family member. So she was the person who would bring me in. And we sat there at a bench right by his altar, and she told me the story of what really happened and how angry they were at Beijing University and still are. So basically, that actual story has never been told in China. Beijing University for the longest time actually kept all the money frozen. And then eventually, when my father was there, there was no negotiations about what to do with the money. My father finally said, make a scholarship. Okay, well, it took all the way till I was there. I think maybe by 98, there was a scholarship in his name. So it took quite a long time. And now there's a bronze statue at Beida. As far as his death, it's still kind of a blur that is not talked about. His persecution is not talked about. So while I was in China for that 3 years, I also was part of the Central Academy of Fine Arts in their folk art research program. I felt that if I'm in China, I really want to understand something really very meaningful about the culture. And so as an artist, in the Central Academy, painting and sculpture was all looking to the West. It was Soviet social realism, you know, photorealism. It was all an imitation of the West. And it was really only in the folk art department that you had something Chinese. And also something I really wanted to understand, because I had a mother who made everything. We weren't even allowed to ever buy things, because my mom would be like, well, we were taught how to weave, knit, crochet, build. She built the furniture, she built the sofa. So, and she could calculate really quickly that it was cheaper to do it by hand and better. So you just never tried. So it made sense that folk arts was the way to go. So I joined this program, and I actually had to first take the HSK, which is like the Chinese TOEFL. And we did make these field trips. There was one main one into what's considered like the cradle of Chinese civilization. Like, this is where, you know, the birthplace. And this is where you find some of real, authentic ancient culture. So ironically, it's in the poorest part of China. And these are areas that, you know, at that time, you had to go all the way to Inner Mongolia and come down with a bus and then by foot. And someone would have to meet you from the village, because there are no signs, there are no roads. And you really can't be out there by nightfall. There are just no lights. So that's what we did. And actually, you know, in these villages that we went to, there was no visual folk art. There was no paper cuts, nothing like that. They were so poor. The population was minuscule. But what they did have that was immense was folk singing. And it's across these huge gullies and valleys that boys and girls would court each other. They would sing. And that is how you would find a mate, is by singing. And in these villages, which are dug out of the earth, it's yellow earth, you know, they're ergonomically, they're, you know, in the winter, they're warmer because it's dug out of the earth. In the summer, it is cooler. And one village in particular, what was really memorable was that there was an older man, and his wife had died. And every single day, for years, at a certain hour, he would sit down and he would sing. And the entire village would gather around him and listen. So, and then he would cry. So we were all there present for when he did that, and I didn't take any photos. I felt that was just something you don't photograph. But you just really felt that this was where the culture is. It's in the singing. And actually, in that village, there was only elderly people and very, very young. Anyone in between had left the countryside by that, and this is 90, 95, 96. And then I went again during New Year's festivals. And then we went into villages that were a little bit less remote, so you could find actual folk crafts. So in this cave dwelling, you see it's still the paper. And then you see the paper cuts, the red paper cuts, and that paper is changed once a year. And it weathers snow and rain. And then, you know, these women do not think of themselves as artists. This is part of life. This is just part of being. And so paper cuts, well, that's something that you do for part of every day, whether it's like making a sample for your embroidery. So that's like your pattern. Or it's for like celebration of birthdays, or a rites of passage, or a funeral, or for protection, or for even witchcraft. So that was just a part of it. They'd never consider, they would just laugh at you if you said that, you know, oh, you're an artist. Or if you, we went around to villages saying, does anyone cut paper flowers? And everyone would say, oh, no, 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 no. But then you would find them on the windows. I mean, that's really how we would find them. But everyone denies that they're, you know, of course I'm terrible at it. So in these villages, money really hasn't reached yet. So of course, you know, and there really isn't kind of anything to exchange money with. There are no stores, and everyone is subsistence. There's not a lot, but they are subsisting on their crops. And if you leave, by the end, when you're leaving and you're at the edge of that valley, the whole town would come with you to say goodbye. And whatever they had, which was very, very little, in some cases it was just wine-soaked dates. They would stuff your pockets. I would say every orifice that you had was stuffed. Right? It's like you're like leaving with all these, and they were delicious, of course, because it was the only thing they had, right? And you were like the excitement of the year. So, okay. Oh, it's too dark. Okay, but this is. Patron, yeah. So she's, you know, what's sad is that these 80-year-old women, the middle age group, they basically usually didn't learn because they weren't interested. It's really only the 80-year-olds. And it's the 80-year-olds with the little kids. And there would be sing songs. There's usually a rhyme. There's often a body tale, you know, with all these paper cuts. And usually everyone can sing. I'm just an animal person, so I was always prone to these things that were a little bit more unusual, like the five poisons, which is more in these really rural areas. Certainly people from Beijing or Shanghai, they would only know it as a reference to five, you know, poisonous politicians, but not actual five poisonous creatures. But in these villages, you have to understand this is agricultural rural living, so poisonous creatures, you know, mosquitoes, these things could really harm your children. So they would make amulets and put protection symbols, paper cuts on your doorways, protect their children with quilts and with all these creatures on them. And I was, of course, really fascinated by them. And also the cruder the paper cut, the more I loved it, the more eccentric. And of course, you know, you bump into a lot of funerary rites. This one's quite elaborate. This is obviously a really wealthy person, and he's got his silver mountain and his gold mountain. And you know, it's also a show of wealth too, and it's also the whole notion that you're sending this off to the dead. You're sending them piles of money, essentially. There was also a big mansion. This is in the 90s in Hebei. Of course, in the cities this is discouraged, but in the countryside you do see this. And back in the academy, well, you know, the academy, all the folk arts, most of that had been burned during the Cultural Revolution or thrown away because that was considered futile or superstitious. So some people had buried them, some people had hidden them, and then a lot of it all came out in the 90s. And I remember in the cabinets of the school, you would open them up and I don't have a picture of this, out would spill like 50 like these handmade pigs and snakes and rabbits. It was the 12 animals, but all the farm animals, and they were all hand embroidered and stitched, and those are the ones I love so much. But really, at the bottom of all this Chinese folk art, the essential thing is that it's an agricultural community, and it's universal. All these symbols, and the head, the former head of that research program, Jing Deling, who was heavily persecuted in his time. He was making these volumes, these thick volumes on each totemic image. And whether it was the, you know, the tree of life image or the girl, you know, the child was basically a paper cut and he's grabbing her ponytails, right? That's also a totemic image. And he was essentially this book, they document all the different, the myriad of variations and also the meanings. What are the meanings? Think about it, the tree of life. This is about fecundity, reproduction, you know, the living system. As far as the Drajiwawa, well, that could be a myriad of things, whether it was about a birthday, it was about fertility, wedding, also witchcraft, scaring away, expelling spirits. But also this book shows also how many comparisons, how many similarities all over the world we have these same things. And in the academy, what was really interesting was everyone wanted to go to Mexico in that department. Why? Because they were all convinced. And you know, in Beijing, near the National Museum of Art, there, at least back then, there was a bookstore that was on socio-anthropology, and it had all these shelves just of books on the connection between ancient pre-Columbian Mexico and China. And page by page of the similarities, dragon after dragon, that were the same from pre-Columbian and China, pre-Columbian and China. So everyone wanted so badly to go to Mexico. And so many of the same rituals, the customs. Think about the Day of the Dead. Think about their paper cuts. Think about they even eat a bun that's the same. I mean, the foods, there are so many endless similarities. And in fact, that paper in China is called Chinese paper. You know, the paper they use for their paper cuts. So all this to say that it is essentially, there's so many universalities. And it's, you know, at the heart of everyone Chinese is a farmer. So when I came back, I was just struck by, you know, the incredibleness of these small villages and their wondrous generosity. And also all these crazy symbols of wealth everywhere that you would see, especially in the city, especially at funerals. And so I was all these different money symbols, and this was called the lament to the god of the wealth. And then I made my versions of the tree of life. And then, I don't know if you could see it, that figure, except for its mouth is burned out, that's my version of the girl with the ponytails. And then you see those poisonous creatures. Again, my mom had told me so many stories of her time in Nanjing. And one of them that always stayed with me was that when she was at Jinling University, and some people here know of Jinling, that was the only place that females could go to college in Nanjing. So it's a very, very famous place, Jinling Girls College. So when she was there, she was a bio major, and that campus was beautiful. It had these dragons, she said it was a blood ox dragon with carvings on the columns. There was Ming Dynasty architecture, there was underground brooks, and the herons would come and nest there. And it was very peaceful because it was just, it was only girls there. And then one day, you know, this is near the foreign areas. So there was a Texaco executive, CEO, stationed in Nanjing, and his son's birthday, and he had a gun. So he came into the campus, and he shot those nesting herons. And my mom, being, and all the girls, they were just shocked, and this is also their first sighting of a foreign boy. My mom said, you know, one of those American foreign boys, you know, with the freckles. And, you know, they were shocked, and no one could dare go near him or touch him until he started to shoot the streetlights. And then that's when someone grabbed him. But my mom, being my mom, you know, in bio, they were trained to taxidermy, to make specimens for the department. So my mom picked up as many of the herons as she could. She draped them over her arm, and the bodies swung back and forth, and she walked back to the lab, and she stayed up all night long, stuffing as many as she could. And she said to me, such long, nice feathers. She had to save them. So for me, this story, I've always had between the site of Jinling also being the supposed safe haven of where they hid the girls from the Japanese soldiers. They tried to stuff as many girls in there, and the community, it was in that campus. And the international community tried to save many girls. It didn't really succeed. But that campus has a special meaning. So I guess really merged all those images of the birds and the hands and the charred bodies. This is also a take on the draji wawa, because you know in a lot of the Shanbei images of paper cuts, the females in the genital area, it was usually a flower. It was their way of describing that area. And so for me at that time, this made a lot of sense to me. So she has nine layers, and then all the birds at the bottom. And then this is my version of the shroud of poison with all the poison creatures on the bottom. There were 300 of them. They were cut out of paper and covered in soot. I learned a technique from the women in the countryside. You know, they don't have Xerox machines. So how would you give a paper cut to your neighbor if you wanted to share that image? So the way they would do it is they would take their paper cut, and they would put it over a bigger piece of paper and spritz it with some water. And then they put it on a piece of wood or a piece of glass, and this is all wet, so the paper sticks together. Then you flip it upside down. You take a candle and you run it underneath it. So now the candle is going on this wet paper. It's going on the paper cut, and it's going on the paper beneath. So every place there's a hole, it's like a stencil. So then you lift it off, you've got a negative and a positive. You know, I also started to think a lot about witch trials, and I was reading a lot about the Salem witch trials, and I realized that, you know, most of the people who were accused of witches were middle-aged women. And there were women who were not married, either they were single, they were widowed, or accused of being perhaps a whore, they were too intelligent, too pretty, too this, too that. So I came up with the phrase witch, whore, widow, and now I think if I were to do it again, I would call it whore, widow, witch, because it's really at the end, that's the final stage, is when you're declared as a witch. And it's interesting because it was just yesterday I was putting this together and I realized, oh my God, I knew these stories back then, but I didn't put it together, but two of my grand aunts were exactly that. You could say accused of being a witch, or you could say in the Cultural Revolution had the misfortune of having their husbands no longer present in this world, and their sons also. One son had been killed by the Japanese for one of the grand aunts, so she was very vulnerable. She didn't have a husband, she didn't have a son, and she had inherited farmland. So she was also the second wife, not the first wife. When the husband died, he had one business, it went to one wife. The farmlands went to the second wife, my grand aunt. So farmlands, Cultural Revolution. The first family, their business did not go well. They were jealous, her farmlands were doing fine. So they helped declare her public enemy number one. So she was regularly taken out and beaten. So they would put her on stage, everything was blamed on her, they would beat her, then they would bring her back, and then pull her out again. This went on for several years until someone took a 2x4, a piece of wood, and clonked her on the head, and that stroke killed her. And the saddest thing about this aunt is that no one remembers her name. And it's also true of the first aunt. That first aunt also lost her husband, and she knew she would be in trouble, so she didn't even wait. She just committed suicide. She took poison. And she too, there is no record of her name. I've asked my father, I've asked every Ding relative that's still alive, what were their names? And we've tried to look on the family tree, and because they were females and they would be married into another family, there's no record. So in a way, I didn't realize it when I made this piece, but I'm sure unconsciously it was somewhere in there. Now I'm tying it all together. So this was my witch fairy. So I also made a piece that was called, the original title was called Collection of Sadness, and then later on it was called
evidence of a questionable life. So when it was called Records of Sadness, it was because I was traveling in China. I was making these small sculptures, and they would live in these plastic bags. Then later on, as I'm reading all these witch trials, I'm realizing, evidence. And how evidence could be anything. So what I did was I took both sculptures and actual things from my life, from the family, and I decided to make a mock witch trial and put myself on trial. So you have anything from like music awards or art awards or things that on this side were considered really exotica, or on that side of the world in China were considered too Western. From the photographs of my mother holding me to what could be considered, you know, like you're a kink here. So we had both sides going on in this piece. So that's an ongoing piece. I keep on finding more things that seem to be appropriate. That's me. It says does not talk, and actually they didn't think I talked when I was in first grade. They actually thought I was mute because I guess didn't talk. You know, I laughed and shouted and screamed when I was home, but I did not talk when I went to school originally here. I think I was really scared. I was the only Chinese kid in the county. So, you know, things like slanted sex or anything that could be blamed, like there are a lot of baby bird deaths this year. You know, boyfriend death, boyfriend died, things of that nature. I also have the photos of Baba Shan in there. This was, I wrote on it, heart of a mother, womb of a whore. That's a saying from Pedro Paramo. Also, now part of this evidence, I've added new things because I keep on finding new things, and this is actually a kind of a wonderful thing, is that Raoyutai, now on the internet, you can actually find out what really happened to him. And this is the amazing thing of the internet, is that you can put down anonymous comments, and now there are memorial sites. This one is Wa Heaven. And one of my father's friends discovered it, and they were so excited. And then I sent this link to my cousins in Beijing, and everyone was just so thrilled. They were like, oh, it's the first time my cousin's in China, and he's like, I can actually really read what happened to him. And anyone could put, and there's many, many, there's lots of comments and stories that are put on this. And then my cousin goes, and he's like, oh, there's a site already existing for my father. So this was like thrilling. And so this is like the way the memorial site looks, and you can press on that, you see that cursor there, and the door is open, you can light a candle, you know. When I first showed it to my dad, and he's like, oh, they built a temple for him, and like, no dad, this is virtual. So this is really kind of an exciting thing for everyone in the family, that this exists, and that you can write and add comments. So I think it's something, if you know of anyone, that you should look them up, see if there's something really interesting written about them. And shortly after this project, my mom suddenly passed away. And I don't know if you can see this clearly, but this is her embroidery, and the embroidery is still there, and the linen cloth is totally worn away. And before she passed away, I saw that pillow, I'm like, we can never throw this away. I'm like, I don't care if it's totally in tatters, I'm gonna find a way to preserve it. I'm like, Mom, cannot throw that away. So all the stuffing is coming out, but that was her handiwork, so I wanted to save it. And it was at this time when, you know, funerals, especially these days, someone comes and takes the body away, you're not allowed to touch it, because I found my mom, you know, you're immediately, the cops have to come, and she had a heart attack and died face down in the plants. So it's a very cold procedure, and you don't get to have any time with the body. So I felt like it was totally like, this is very strange. So I felt like this is all wrong. I have to do something. And we didn't really follow any religion. Actually, my family had been blacklisted from the Lutheran Church. That's a whole nother story. So I grew up without any religion at all. The family became incredibly cynical. And so first I was looking at, well, what's within traditional Chinese, which was burning of these paper objects. And so I'm looking at the stores, and what do you have? You have money. You have, you know, a Rolex watch. You have a Gucci handbag. You have an iPad. And my mom would have cursed me. So I tried to buy like this sweater set, and then I was so disappointed. I opened it up and I'm like, it's only the front. There's no back, there's no seams, you know? I was like, this costs $6. So I realized, oh wait, I'm an artist. I can make her things that actually have meaning. And then that's what I really feel after a while. What is culture? What is memory? What is mourning? It's all about things that have meaning. So she had this incredible garden. So, and it's true, in the first spring without her, all the daffodils popped out and they revealed themselves. And I was really excited that things were growing, things were moving, things were happening, but my mom couldn't see them. So I made her two dozen. There are two different varieties in that garden. So I tried to make all the different varieties. And as I was making them, thinking, oh, mom would be like, that one doesn't look right. And that one, that looks like a dead daffodil. That doesn't look right either. So, but it would be a process to think about her, to mourn her. And then I thought about her paintings. So I made her, I made her brushes. And I spent weeks making these like as realistic as I could, because I knew she would critique me. I actually took Chinese brush painting class with my mom. I actually took her to the Taiwan Cultural Center, and I subjected myself to that because, of course, I'm going to be criticized, and I'm much worse than my mom. And she said to me, well, at least you're better than any of the white people. So I'm like, thanks, Mom. I'm glad I am. But that was one of the happiest times, was because she was busy doing something, and she, and I was there too as well, and she had a community. And I think that's ultimately all that we want. We want a community. We want to have our children around us. We want to feel useful. And then I made, you know, I had bought a pan. And this pan I put, you know, was to bake these little acorn cakes. And I meant to bake these acorn cakes and put them in a basket and bring them home to mom, because I thought, oh, she'd think they're so cute. And you know what? I never did it. So later on, I have this pan and I felt so sad. And I'm like, oh, I'm going to make paper ones. And I'm going to take yellow ochre watercolor wash and put them over the acorns. And then I will burn them. So I spent 2 weeks making all these things, and I photographed them and I burned them, and I cried. And I thought to myself, oh, what will I make next time? You know, and then there was the list of all the things that I could make. You know, I could make the roast duck, the black bean moon cakes, the fuzzy cat to follow her around, her magnolia tree, the greenhouse she wanted, the toy bear you dreamt of in China but you never got. So I realized also while I was doing this, that this is a way to have community and to grieve. So I made a project. I made a project, I wrote a grant, I contacted the Rubin Museum, and there we had it. We had a group of total strangers, and it was pretty much like what I imagined. People who don't know each other, but everyone's lost someone. And everyone got it really quickly. You didn't have to explain. And people made what had to think about, what is that thing that symbolizes that relationship? It's not the Rolex watch, it's not the iPad, it's not the expensive thing, it's just that simple thing. So people made their mother's apron, and inside, you know, her mother was an immigrant, so she put a page from the Webster's Dictionary. She put all these like little addresses and things that her mother kept. She even dusted it with flour. And then she realized, my mom was a Holocaust survivor. I don't want to burn it. So I said, fine. And she buried it next to her mom's grave. That was all part of the process. This person, she made breakfast. Dad ate this interesting combination of bananas and coffee. So that's what she made. Good morning, Dad. And a policeman walked in. And what did he make? a bulletproof vest for a colleague who died while on duty. So, and this was one of my students whose nephew was murdered as a baby. And she said, "I only have one thing to say. I wish I got to meet you." And so she made him a baby bottle and a skateboard. So here we have, you know, a high-speed train for grandfather, a bowl of porridge, a shrimp, flowers, a laptop with, you know, constant Wi-Fi, free Wi-Fi in heaven. There's nail polish to keep her nails. There's a stuffed roast pepper, prayer beads. It's whatever you want it to be. And usually they're very, very simple. And in this project, people who were angry at their father forgave them. People who had intense conflicts, people whose relatives had committed suicide, this all kind of came out in these letters. And it was really interesting because people of all different religions just did it. They just got it. So this is an ongoing project. It's something I eventually want to make a book of because it's very interesting. It's really the myriad of ways that we mourn and we remember. So I've done it. This is the Rubin group. And usually afterwards what we do is we burn it together. And while it's burning, everyone's face is very, very tense. And by the time the flames are gone and all the paper is burned, everyone's face relaxes. It's like you can kind of release a little bit. And then we eat. Everyone brings some food. Well, these are my students. And we do this in a garden. So that's, these are again thinking about my mom and the chaos of the birds and the grief and the women. So much to remember, so much I long to forget. And then I think about what I have inherited from my mom. Remember, this is the Pan family, and when they were married, yes, there were ivory presents. And yes, at one point, my mom, when they bought this house and I was a baby, she asked a relative going back to Hong Kong, and at that time, I think this ivory was like $20, but at that time, this is a long time ago, this is in the 60s, $20 is a lot of money. And yes, there was an ivory laughing Buddha. And I don't know if you noticed it in the very first slide, which actually included the box of my mom's ashes, there was an ivory Guanyin. Very ironically, the goddess of mercy. So, and then you see that ball, that's eight balls, and inside there's another ball, and inside it's a very elaborately carved. And it was, it stood on that stand, and it later on broke. And look, there's a piece of coral. These things at one point were in the living room because at one point my mom was proud to have these objects. She felt that the laughing Buddha and the Guanyin was going to protect our household. And then later, during the time period where it came out in the news and CITES came in and there was a ban on ivory, my mom saw those news and programs and she felt really embarrassed. And so then it went from the living room into her bedroom. But nevertheless, I still inherited them. And so then I'm left thinking about, what am I going to do about this? And I have to face up to the reality of what they are, not what they symbolize. So, and in thinking about it, the word Guanyin, the word mercy, the word compassion, that was so much a part of my growing up. My mom used to shriek, "God have mercy on us." She used to do all such, and she would shriek and she would faint. She would pretend to drop dead. So the word mercy was huge. And the word Guanyin was huge, as well as compassion. But when I look at that statue, and now at that Lofo with his grinning teeth, and this is ivory. So you have to recontextualize. And I thought, what am I going to do about this? And at this time, now, we're in 2010, we're not in the 80s and 90s, and China and ivory has become the thing. And this is a car covered in ivory. I don't know how many elephants is that? What is it, you know, a herd? How many mothers and babies are killed in the process, or babies killed because the mothers are gone. And then we have the beautiful model to the side and all the, you know, the luxury of it all. And here we have the reality. And then the reality is that for the locals, this is money. This is a bribe. This is something to feed their children. And then it's the community of the elephants. And just like I was a baby who followed my mom around, here is the baby elephant who can't follow its mom around. And so, you know, people might say you don't want to, I always forget that word, anthropomorph. Thank you, Brent. Thank you. And I would switch it around. Well, what about if we were like the elephants? What about if we stuck together like a herd and defended all our young? What if there was a blind elephant and we walked with it every day? What if all the females helped each other during birth and helped feed the young? So what if that was the case? If we were more like elephants as social beings and as a community, because we aren't. And here we have Chairman Mao in ivory. And it's come to my attention that really it's so much is in these iconic figures, these statues. Why? Because ivory is something that you could carve very, very deeply. My mom used to say that the carving is so good in ivory because it's so deep. And it's the care about this precision and that kind of craftsmanship because it's bone, solid bone. And we remember that the elephant, this is going all the way up his face, and in order to get it out, you have to hack off part of his face. And so here we have, this was the New York Ivory Crush, which I went to, and you see all these Chinese cultural objects. And this was the, so you see all these statuaries, and then you see some of the same symbolism that we learned when I was in the Central Academy about fecundity and prosperity and fertility, all these fruits and things with seeds and all this life force. And the reality, there's no life force there, it's all completely dead. This was the fish and wildlife, so you have all these confiscated objects which all largely go to China. And this is in Guangzhou, the turtle market. This is a recent picture. You know, the majority of turtles are all endangered. There was even a film about a man who was trying to rescue all the endangered turtles. He lived in Brooklyn, and he was taking the turtles from the market in Chinatown, and many of them were endangered species. You know, people didn't realize that would be a $5 turtle. You chop its head off and eat it as soup. But he actually recognized that these were rare species. He was trying to save them all. That poor man, he ended up with thousands of turtles. Some of the, he was the guardian of some of the last. And in the end, he lost his lease, he was kicked out, and he became homeless. There's a film on it. And he drove those turtles, and he gave them to people he knew could care for him. I don't know what happened to that man. Last, at the end of the film, he is homeless. No one came to the rescue. There was no Indiegogo campaign. You know, and here we have the bear claws. And these are all luxury, luxury goods. We don't need them. That's an exotic dish. You know, so we're all trying to, these were some things from a show I had from excerpts from a dysfunctional forest. And you see in the back there, those are earrings. It was a hummingbird made into earrings in Victorian times. It was just the body of the hummingbird. You know, we're trying to put them in containers and own them and claim them. I don't know if it's because we want to be animals. We envy them. Are we jealous? What is it that we must obtain them, that we can't look from a distance? Even in our selfies, the craze with the selfies where you have to like just grab it and bend it, bend the poor swan till it's like in the picture with you, even if it kills the swan. Or the dolphin or the shark that people are pulling out of the water too long so that it dies for that selfie. There is this desire to possess. And I think there's some kind of, I think perhaps, and maybe you can ponder on it, is it that we wish to own it? Is it that we are jealous that we don't have enough fur or feathers? That we simply can't look from afar? And this is a fashion model with this huge fur headdress. And it struck me recently, everyone recognizes the beckoning cat. That is a Japanese icon. And you know, most Chinese usually do not claim Japanese icons for their own. There still exists that animosity between Japanese and Chinese, but this has been claimed and is beloved. And it's really interesting to me. I see garages and restaurants that all have this cat, huge, fat, gold. The Japanese one is much more subdued. It's not gold. It doesn't look like it has a mustache. And I've even seen a garage where this cat was huge and golden, and it was even higher than all the other gods. It was placed above the Guanyin. So here we have this beckoning cat, which is beckoning what? It's beckoning money. It's beckoning the wealthy man to come in. And if you really look into what is the history of this icon, this is the icon of the courtesan. And if you look into it, there was a show at the Folk Art Museum in San Diego about this icon. And it was this Japanese courtesan who had a cat which wore a scarf with a gold piece here. And she was beautiful. And she went into this bar, and she had a bar that was called the Golden Cat. And she could lure the wealthiest men there, and she completely bankrupted them. Okay, so this is where this image is coming from. And there's this whole notion, if the arm is one direction, it's the occupations of the night. If it's the arm on the other side, it's occupations of the day. But this is to bring in money, nothing more than that. And that box, now I've added all these arms because I feel like it's not even important that the cat has a head, it's just about these arms. It's like the thousand-armed Guanyin. Right? So this cat just has lots of arms, more money, more money. And that box, I saved that box because if you read the side, it's like, you know, it's not a 3-in-1, it's like a 20-in-1. Because this cat is good for everything, for like graduation, it's for weddings, it's for, you know, a good job. It's right, you know, you name it, this cat will bring you money and luck. Okay? So I just think it's interesting that this is the icon that we're embracing. And I do like cats. When I was in the Galapagos, I was so horrified because as a Chinese person traveling with turtle conservation scientists, I was really aware of, you know, all these looks and the reality that the Chinese had come in to the Galapagos, the precious Galapagos, and bribed a restaurant owner had come in and he had bribed the local fishermen. Yes, to illegally fish to a huge scale, the Galapagos, the endemic, the only in Galapagos sea cucumber. And in 10 years, almost completely wiped it out. And you can think, so what, it's a sea cucumber. But just like the elephant, the lion, the tiger, the sea cucumber, they all have that role. And they're all really important. And so now, they understand, okay, so the Galapagos Park and Wild Aid and Sea Shepherd have stepped up. There's a satellite there to try and track poaching activities, these boats, high-speed boats that are going through. They're trying to change some of the laws going on. It's supposed to be only artisan fishing in the Galapagos. Oh, that's also from the Ivory Crush. And I had this idea, what am I going to do with that Guanyin? So I wanted to have an individual crush. And even though mine dates all the way back to the 60s, it doesn't make a difference. It's still the bone of an elephant. And even though my mother didn't understand it, that's what it is. And some Buddhists have said to me, but it's a Buddhist icon. You can't destroy it. And when I thought really long and hard about this. I even talked to a Tibetan Lama about it. And he said, think carefully about it. Just make sure it's something you don't want to regret. And I have, and I really feel like, I don't think it represents the Laughing Buddha. I don't think it represents the Goddess of Mercy. So I don't have a qualm with destroying it. And as far as, you know, the memory of my mom, I have so much more that can replace that. So I made this project because I became kind of really obsessed with this whole problem. And people said to me, "You're in New York. How can this make a difference?" And I felt like, well, the reality is, I really think and feel we're so interconnected with the internet. And the reality is that we are all only one step away from a consumer in any number of these products, two steps away from a seller, and three from a poacher. It's just a little hop, skip, and a jump. So I decided, I took this drawing initially, I guess because it was a drawing I did of a live elephant. And you had to draw really fast, and I thought it captured, you know, the movement and the weight of the elephant. I guess I had a few minutes to do it. And so I made these cold calls. I'm not normally one to call up people that I don't know, but I called up Wild Aid, I called up WCS, 96 Elephants, Animals Asia, and they said, okay. And, you know, from there I decided to, okay, we're gonna work with the Chinese community, and I'm gonna work with the Ganjie community. So I teach sculpture, and we make recycled animals. And sometimes I tell them to make endangered species. And sometimes I just let them make whatever animal they want. So I looked in my shelves, and I'm like, oh, okay, well, the elephants, the rhinos, they can go. And I'm like, an owl can't go, can it? And then the more I looked, I was horrified, because nearly every animal in the storage unit and from prior years could go into that shell. They are all subject to mass harvesting, illegal poaching for the Chinese market. And that, to me, was horrifying. I discovered that owls are being eaten, and that was a delicacy. Turtles, I knew about. Shark, I knew about. The vaquita, which is a byproduct of the totoba, which is being killed for its the swim bladder as a delicacy. And so we had all these different animals that could go in. We have octopus, the lesser panda. Yes, the lesser panda gets eaten too as an exotic food dish. And the pangolin, which is one of the most heavily poached animals in the world. And all the owls. And then also for the exotic pet trade, we had all the South American birds, the tropical birds, they could all come too. And I display them on all these boxes, these shipping boxes, because that's how they get smuggled. And so, you know, at first I was just making elephants, you know? And then I was reading and I realized that these elephants that know they're being targeted, they're so smart, they're aware that they're being followed, and they know who is gonna be a friend and who's gonna be a foe. So some of the elephants, especially the big tuskers, they move really slowly and they hide the tusk. So I have this one that's kind of blending in with the paper so it can't be seen. And sadly, those big tuskers, most of them are vanishing. And at this point, even the babies get killed because they have a little stub. And the rhinos are probably in worse shape than the elephants. And that is just simply for their horn, which is mixed in with like a alcoholic beverages so that you could be more virile. And then I just put the hands and the feet and the birds all together because we're basically all the same thing. And then I invited a Tibetan Lama to speak. And it was actually a full house that day. A lot of people got turned away. I had the Wild Aid videos going on all the time. I selected about 12 of them. And I realized that people in the U.S. had never seen them. Most New Yorkers didn't know anything about this, especially the Chinese, including all the PhD people. And one time when I came to Ari last year at the Christmas, at the Lunar New Year party, and everyone asked, "What project are you working on?" And I said, "Mine." People kind of tilted their head. And then later on, professors came over to me and said, "Oh, well, you know, when I was little, my grandma told me that the elephant tusk just falls off." And I even talked to my dad. And my dad is the winner of the Humboldt, the U.S. Senior Scientist Humboldt Award. And he said, oh, but in my time it was different. In my time, there was the elephant cemeteries. And that's where they got the ivory. And you know, my mom had said the same thing too before she saw all those nature programs. She had said that, well, there's this cemetery and elephants grieve, and they all bring the tusks of their dead beloved loved ones to the cemetery and leave them there. And I grew up thinking that there was this like mystical secret garden world of all these tusks. And that's what became our objects. So, you know, and I talked to all my friends. I started to like open my mouth and, you know, bring this up whenever possible. And I got all these strange replies from people who had degrees, from Academy Film Award winners, from documentary filmmakers, from people of all walks of life. And they were saying things like, oh, but the shark fin, it grows back, you know, as it drowns and bleeds to death. And I realized that people had, you know, they could be so brilliant in their field, but they had absolutely no knowledge of basic anatomy, of animal anatomy. And it was astounding. They thought that turtles could walk out of their shells and be fine, that it wasn't connected to their body. This wasn't their spine. So then I really realized we have to start to educate. So I invited the summer camp groups over. I gave them tours. We drew. We talked about this. And I was really heartened that the young Chinese kids knew about them. In fact, the little boys were like, we eat those too? And they were all discussing it. So I even showed a film. And everyone said to me, there was a person who does a film festival, and she said to me, this is not going to work, Mary. No one's going to come to a film that's called Cages of Shame. Can't you show Big Bird in China? And I'm like, I don't want Big Bird in China. I need a film that addresses traditional medicine. And I need a film that shows the Chinese participating in a positive way as well. And this film was perfect. Because in this film, you saw the bears in their most horrible, you know, for they spend their life in these low cages, in these catheters, these metal catheters, and they're milked. And in this film, there was negotiations, and these bears were sold and taken to a sanctuary. But they had to go on this long journey from Xi'an all the way to Chengdu. And on the way, one bear was dying. This bear still had part of the catheter inside of him, and they had to do surgery on the truck. But of course, they're in the Chinese traffic jam of a lifetime. These traffic jams can go on for days. But as things in China are, they can be one extreme or the other, and miracles can happen. And so the word passed on, and sure enough, the police, the traffic security, everyone let the bear truck go. And sure enough, they contacted the local hospital. And yes, they were all waiting with the oxygen tank and everything that was needed. And the entire town stayed up all night long watching the bear go through its surgery. How often do you get to see that? And yes, everyone was so happy. They pulled an all-nighter together watching this bear. And this bear survived and lived in the sanctuary for 7 more years. His name was Oliver. So this was us watching this film. And what was so wonderful at the end of this film, when it's like exhausting, you're just going through the whole thing, it's shot in live time. And then at the end, what happens? They're all exhausted, they finally make it to Chengdu, and it's 7 a.m., and now what is it? The Buddhist monks have arrived. They've heard about the bears. And now they are blessing the bears and blessing all the tanks. They're blessing everything. So I wanted this film because this film showed that the Chinese could have compassion and they could understand and things could change. And in fact, even though Vietnam has officially closed all their sanctuaries, they cannot build more sanctuaries, they cannot have more bear ball farms. You understand the reason for bear ball farms is that it used to be that you just killed it, and if you instead keep the bear alive, you can constantly milk it. It's in permanent torture. but you can keep on getting more bare biofuel. So what's happening now is in China, it still exists. However, there was one farm that had something like 200 bears, and the daughter became a Buddhist, and she convinced her dad that this was not okay. So there we have another entire farm, this is in Nanjing, that is being turned over. And the father who used to farm the bear was now concerned about the bear. And he even stayed through the operations of his bears. And the former bear farm workers are being taught to care for the bears. So there are ways things can change. And that was one individual person who changed her dad. So I invited a traditional medicine doctor who was not privy to all this information. She was not, she knew what the topic was, but she was not necessarily pro-animal. But she was my doctor, and she came, and she had done some research before she came, and she watched that film, and she was shocked. And she told me how she had seen on one of the chat sites, she told the whole audience about how there was a video that went viral in China. And we don't, I think this may be that it's actually not true, but it still went viral, of a bear, a mother bear that was in a cage, and she saw its baby bear, and it was her baby, and she went ballistic, she went crazy. She couldn't bear to see, she knew her bear is gonna be in the same condition as hers. So she broke out of the cage and ripped her baby to shreds. And this was on video, and it went all over in China. So, so she said to me, we should put this film on my chat site because there are a lot of traditional medicine doctors, there's a lot of people on these sites, and that is a way to spread messages without spending a dime, without having to cross an ocean. And so then I also had an action panel day, so I invited the former person, Patrick Kwan, whose dad is a Chinese restaurant owner. And Patrick led the band for the shark fin ban in New York City. So that's going contrary to your dad. His dad was in fact like the restaurant association president, the Chinese restaurant association. So Patrick really was like this renegade, but he got it done. He was able to get a ban on shark fin in New York City restaurants. So, and Patrick said to me, and I said something to him, oh, but then there's the NRA, there's a this, there's a that. And he's like, Mary, the NRA, how many people are in the NRA? He's like, you realize there are actually not that many. But what is strong about the NRA is they know their numbers, the telephone numbers by heart, of all their politicians, of all the officials, and they bug them all the time. He's like, if every one of us did that, we would get things done too. So WCS also appeared. There was also someone who was a wildlife criminologist who came, and she was talking about leopard predation. So there was a discussion. And there's my dad. And I still have discussions with him about, because I spotted a piece of ivory in his glass case. I'm like, Dad, that fisherman, he's ivory. He's like, no, it can't be, it was so cheap. I'm like, well, there was a time when ivory was cheap. You know, an ivory necklace at one point was really expensive. It's, now it's way more than the price of gold. So I've gone on to look at other symbols that we have in Chinese culture. And you know how you have the see no evil, hear no evil monkeys? And we all think it's really cute. Right? It's like, oh, see no evil, hear no evil. And so I did some digging around, and that's actually an image that comes from, they all believe it comes from Confucian culture. And the idea is actually to not speak of evil, to not hear of evil, to not do evil. But then it's getting kind of warped over time. And the Japanese were the ones that put the monkey image on it, and you see that in Japanese temples. And then I started to look further, and here you have it in this billboard. And what it is, the Oak Ridge workers. What you see here, what you do here, what you hear here, when you leave here, let it stay here. And I thought so much about what's happening these days in China and everywhere where people don't dare to say anything. And one of the times when I was in China and this man, this farmer, there were these oranges that fell off the back of his little bicycle kind of wagon. And I ran over and I started to pick up the oranges and putting them in his truck. And my friend says to me, "Stop, stop, what are you doing? Put it all down, leave it on the ground." And he was this immediate that, like, absolutely, he's like hitting my hand. And the reality is there's such fear of being sued that no one would dare to help each other. And there's fear of it being misunderstood and all these kind of craziness. So this notion of helping is like turned backwards. This notion of intelligence has become warped. The notion of, you know, all these words, 聪明, what is intelligent? What is intelligent is now what is clever. What is ultimately that you can find your way around it. When I spoke to my cousin's son, who's my nephew, he's now in the University of Buffalo, and he grew up not knowing who his uncle and who his relatives were, and he found out when he came to the US. And when I told him, "Well, your great-grand-uncle is the founder of Chinese modern physics. That should be incredible." And in a way, he died with all his integrity. And you know what he said to me? He's like, he died a fool. You know, he's not like the two, Li and Yang, the Nobel Prize winners. One has a girlfriend that's 40 years younger than him. He has how much money? Those are the heroes. They have money. They have young girls. And our relatives, he thought they were an embarrassment. He was ashamed. And I thought, my God, we've flipped everything upside down. So, you know, real intelligence is foolish, and being cunning and strategic is intelligence. What you used to call your younger sister is now the prostitute, the mistress. So everything is sort of gotten warped. One of my last trips, on the cover of Mingbao, it was right at the time of the when you sweep the graves. And sure enough, on the cover was someone who was like one of these entrepreneurial peasants, and he was coming out with a new one. And there's all this, like, you know, get rich is glorious and all these entrepreneurial spirits. And what did he have? He had a paper sexy girlfriend to send to your dead father. And I'm like, what about your mother? She's not gonna like that one. But it was just, it's just considered like the cool thing, you know? And that was considered, isn't that great? That's such an interesting new, like, way to make money. He's being clever and creative. So it's with all this distress that, you know, we have to look at all this. And this monkey, when in fact monkeys very much see the evil, they hear the speak evil, and they speak of evil if they can. And these are lab monkeys. But it was not just about lab monkeys. This monkey, at the end of his feet, oh, keep on moving, he had this little strip of piece of paper, and it was this phrase. "So Indonesia is burning. Why is the world looking away? For all the palm oil." And then, you know, there's a Chinese classic. That's the Chinese version of these, like, wonder cabinets, of these incredible geographies of worlds that far beyond that we don't know of, exploring worlds. It's like the wonder cabinets. And this classical edition, and I have a woodblock version, there's a nine-headed bird. Okay, and here I'm thinking, oh, that's interesting, a nine-headed bird, and the Chinese are no different than the Europeans. They all have all these mythical creatures. And then I heard a story about this nine-headed bird. If you read the actual text, there's not much information. They just talk about, you know, oh, and he lives here, and in the West Mountains, this is here, this is there. It's really not interesting reading. But then I read something else somewhere, and I haven't been able to find the text, but it talked about this nine-headed bird, and how it was always bleeding from the mouth here. And what was happening was that because it had nine heads, when it came time to eating, they couldn't take their turn. So they all fought each other because they wanted that food. And so they were all bloodied and no one got any food. And I thought, wow, that's really like what's going on in society. Everyone's clamoring on top of each other, climbing, you know, literally in all different ways, from parents, you know, trying to help their kids cheat on exams, bribing on every which way. So how do we get ahead instead of taking our turn? So I thought this was like the perfect kind of image. So I have, you know, these bird heads, like half of them are off or disconnected or they're eating each other. Here's another version of it. And it's really not about birds, it's about people. And so whenever I get a chance, this was like a show in Florida, and I would normally not care about having a piece in Florida, but I thought, there's so much plastic in the world, and there's that turtle that had the straw up its nose. So I made a turtle and put a straw up its nose and sent it off to Florida. I've decided that, you know, as an artist, I don't care where I show. What I do care is where the message is getting to. And that's what's meaningful. It's all about meaning. So when I had a chance to work in the market, and this market was not recycling, I decided to use all their materials and to bring in the girls' club. And we were going to be making things like flowers and bees and butterflies and talk about the problem of the pesticides. And here is my monkey. It was the year of the monkey. And speaking about pesticides, you know, in China, in Sichuan, there's one area that has no more bees. Why? Because that area has been sprayed so heavily with pesticides that all the bees have died out. And then they waited a while and the bees came back, but then the people sprayed again. So it is in this desire for the perfect fruit, the fruit that doesn't have the bumps and the bites and the bruises. It's that desire for the glow and the beautiful. It's all the same thing, whether it's the Guanyin or the money or the... And that's actually what leads us to all this trouble. So that village to this day has no more bees, and they self-pollinate. They pollinate by hand, and every single person in the village comes in and does hand pollination. It's very time consuming. So this piece was something, this poem that I had known about years ago, and I decided now, in lieu of all this pesticides and all these problems, when we kill the nervous system of insects, we also kill our own nervous systems. So I decided to link this poem, which is about a composer at an artist residency, and he's in love with, or he thinks he's in love with, this older Japanese artist. And so he's with her, and then when they stop at her door, she says to him, "I know you'd like to have me, but you should know that I had a double mastectomy." And he stares at her, he's like, "Huh?" And she's like, "I don't have any breasts." And then he's backing away, he's like, "Oh, no, sorry, can't do it." And so the next day, he finds at her door, his doorstep outside his studio, a bowl with all these dead bees in it and some roses. And later on, you know, years later, I'm thinking about dead bees. Why would you even have so many dead bees in your studio? That's kind of unusual. And I was thinking, maybe they sprayed. So at any rate, I decided to muse about this and call it a story about the bees round up neonicotinoids in the body and make a ball. These are pipe cleaner bees, of dead bees and some dried flowers. And so this is Manhattan, 57th Street by 5th Avenue. And he tells me, I've gone into this store many a time, and they tell me it's mammoth ivory, so that's a loophole. And as soon as I walk in, now they kind of know me, but before, they all get excited because they think I'm hopefully a Japanese or Chinese tourist, and they lead me right to these Natsukis. And I decided that, you know, honestly, these images have to say what they really want to say. So I took my mother's Guanyin, and that's her landscape painting, and transposed it with the slaughtered elephant, because that's what we're really dealing with here. And here is the Laughing Buddha. And so now, what do we have? It's not just animals, it's not just tigers and lions and elephants and bears and sharks. There's also the rare wood There's also coral. The list is getting really long. I'm on every feed, and people send me all the latest on this all the time, and it's really depressing. I heard recently that as a replacement for elephant, they're looking at the hornbill. They're calling it red ivory. You know, the hornbill, the African hornbill bird, that big crested bill, as that's another, again, the solid bone that you can carve. So, you know, this was a list that, this was something that Wild Aid had put out. And I looked at it and I'm like, that doesn't cover it all. That's only six animals. So I started to add onto it. So we've got the lions in place of tiger, and I have heard that from people. I've also heard that, you know, that the whole reasoning, the rationale, and I'm not here to criticize Chinese traditional medicine, it's centuries old, and I myself as a child did things like, was given things like turtle shell for colds and things like that. But now there are so many other alternatives, there's simply no reason for it. But, you know, what I spoke to someone, she said the reason for tiger is simply because tigers run fast. They're strong, they're ferocious, and that's what's desired. It's the characteristics of the animal, and that's why I think we're somehow really jealous. We're somehow not happy with what we are, that we want to possess those things. So now the list is longer. We've got sea cucumber, seahorses, coral, hornbill, tropical hardwoods, corals twice. And of course, there's the never-ending exotic pet trade. I've been doing some work as also some of my students to help out Born Free on their investigations about exotic pet trade. And I have to say, every day I have to log at least 50 more animals. And this is, yes, on the US pet trade. And to see these baby monkeys that, and they write, just pulled off the mom, ripped off the mom, so you know that they're just literally weeks old. And what are they wearing? They put them in baby clothing and diapers. It's like some kind of warped thinking that this is a toy or a doll. So part of this lecture is to brainstorm and also to say that quite simply, culture is living, it's breathing. And one time when I was in a recent panel, and the other people were all biologists, I was the only artist, and one happened to specialize in butterflies in the Asian tropical rainforests. And he said to me, there are no vertebrates in Chinese rainforests. They're just all gone. If someone wants to do a study, they go to the market to buy it. And when I set off traps, when they set off traps, they usually catch people. They don't catch anything with a vertebrate. He's a butterfly man, so he still has species. So it sort of come to, and then he said to me that he was teaching class, and I said, well, how are your students on this? Because he was teaching conservation ecology in China. And I said, well, how are your students reacting about this? And he said, not well. And I said, you know, because he actually at one point just got so frustrated, and he said, it's your culture that's doing this. And of course, they acted really irate and defensive, you know, it's my culture. But I understood what he meant, and I've been musing about this, I've been thinking about this. How can culture do that? That is the excuse for why you buy that object. You're trying to buy culture. You're trying to buy the diploma without having to do the work of real culture. What's real culture? It's reading, it's drawing, it's appreciating, right? Culture is sharing with your mother or eating a meal that's not made out of a bear's paw, right? So I started to think, well, really, culture is like a garden. It changes, it's alive. Culture has new inventions. It takes what is traditional and warps it into something else that is still cultural, still has the links, but it's still contemporary. It works with what's happening now. So it's with that thought that I wanted to end.
Maybe we could take three questions.
Does anyone have a question?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I have one question. I saw the picture about your grandfather. It's spelled as D-I-N-G, and then later on they changed it to T-I-N-G. Is it because of the cultural revolution?
Oh, no. It's just that when my father was in Shanghai, the romanization at that time was T-I-N-G, but the pinyin is ding.
D-I-N-G.
Yeah, yeah. So my father spells it as T-I-N-G, but all the relatives in China are going by pinyin, so it's D-I, the character is the same. It's the same name, yeah.
It's a very, very moving talk. A few times I want to cry. It was like amazing story about your background and history, and then really the main idea is about integrity of the past. And then as like you slowly talk about grief and the commercialization of the new world, and then the loss of culture, or like the loss of integrity in culture, that was very, very daunting.
You.
And I just want to ask if you have any thoughts about resurrecting the integrity in our culture.
Well, I feel like, you know, some of the projects I was doing, there, it's from a contemporary point of view, but in taking the grief and being able to sit down and reflect and talk, that's something that in Chinese culture we don't do. So that's a contemporary, maybe it's, you know, people would say that's an ABC thing. You know, you're an American-born Chinese, you're like diluted, and you're not concentrate. But I do feel that there is a lot of creativity going on. It's just in small little nooks and crannies. There are ivory carvers who do not want to be associated with a bloody craft and are trying to promote, we can carve other materials, sustainable materials. There are things like that. There are pockets of people who are doing things like having a whole kind of thing of, you know, shark fin free weddings. So there are these pockets of people doing things. I guess feel like they need to be repercussions more and more and more. And I think that even if it's in the smallest of way, that for example, each person has probably a sphere of 20, right? And if you're a teacher, you have more than 20. So within that sphere, if somehow something is getting across, and if those people are moved enough to further their sphere, then things do happen. And again, with chat sites, with putting on images, these walled aid things are really powerful, but the problem with those PSAs is that they're not played 24/7. They only have so much airtime, and it's like during some big event, you know, during the Olympics or during something, so that they play them, but then they have to go on and do airtime in Vietnam and do airtime in Hong Kong, and it's not always playing in China or Shanghai or Beijing, and it's never played here in New York, which is why I was playing them. You know, and I think that part of the thing is that we have to think out of the box. As an artist, I'm doing things that are not typical of an artist. I wouldn't normally put wild aid PSAs in my art show, and I did have to say to the gallery, well, this is part of it and it's very critical. Because people who walk into the show that, you know, aren't going to really look at the art or read, they see Jackie Chan, they will stop. And everyone from the guys delivering the takeout to the mailman, they all stopped and they watched. So, and they're very well made, those PSAs, so why not use them? They've made more than 84 of them. So I feel like there's all these ways. I guess refuse, you know, some of the Chinese news reporters locally said to me, oh, but what can we do? You're just one person. And I'm like, you're a news reporter. And I just feel that I refuse to accept that. And I also feel that in this lifetime while we're here, you have to do something with it. And that's one thing my dad has always said, you must do something. You know, he's 90 and he goes by a walker to his office. He's emeritus and he goes with his walker. He's completely hunched over. He's like, he doesn't see across the street, and he goes to his office every other day and he's still writing papers. I think all the 90-year-old mathematicians that I know are still working. So there's this notion that you must do something. So with that, I can't write a math paper, but I can try and do other things. So that's my thought. So I'm just hoping that everyone, in whichever way, and I know most, probably no one here buys ivory or rhino horn, but you might have ivory or own ivory or have inherited it. Or you might eat sea cucumber or shark fin or any of these delicacies, and maybe you didn't even know it. But maybe now you'll be more conscious of it. And if you see it being sold, you'll think twice about it, and you might even say something to the person, the restaurant owner. And I think that these kind of ripple effects really do matter. So.
One more question?
I just feel that you want to leave people with a sense of your work, Mary. Do you have any piece made of paper here?
Oh, actual work?
Yeah.
No.
Well, everybody has to go see Mary's work. And you have to see the sensibility that you've just heard.
Actually,
the paper itself.
The nine-headed bird is actually on display now. And there's this also this spider kind of creature. And the title of that spider creature is called I Know Who I Am. Do you? And I feel like maybe that's part of why we're in awe of animals, or we want to kill them or claim them, because they know who they are. There's no, like, midlife crisis. They just are, and they just be, and they know what to do. We're the ones that have all these conflicts and problems and issues.
Where is it being shown?
That's actually at the Manhattan Graphics Center. I can give you the address later. Is that my only show up right now? You can just go to my website, but you won't see the stuff in person. It does need to be seen in person. Because I think you get a lot more of a tactile quality.
The other thing is that you're talking about Chinese culture in terms of its problems, but I think really your whole sensibility in dealing with paper, all the things that you're teaching us in terms of being able to grieve and product in a way that uses paper, that whole sensibility of paper comes from China.
Oh, absolutely, 100%. I mean, that's why I said from the beginning, growing up with my mom's screen that just appeared, or the woodblock prints. I mean, that is the mustard seed garden manual. That is like one of the, again, a classics in the painting manuals, and that I actually got to pour over it as a from age two all the way on. That was probably like my first coloring book. It's hugely influential, I think, in everything from design, composition, sensibility, etc. So that there's no denial on that. Actually, when I was in the academy, the professors would say things like, oh, she draws like a boy, which I decided was a compliment. And I do think that there are positive things happening, but we need so much more of them. Since the governments are not acting up to speed fast enough, this is really where individuals make a difference. And if we could start an actual revolution, so to speak, where these things are totally not cool, in fact, it's like an embarrassment to be having ivory in your home. It's an embarrassment to be doing all these things. It's the ultimate uncool. Which is one of the things that I've been thinking about, is to what can we make cool? You know, what is the way that people can still spend their money, show off, and feel great? I mean, I'm not arguing that notion. We just have to put it towards a better usage. Can we make these incredibly gaudy plaques, $500,000 donations to Wild Aid or the Lion Shields or the African Wildlife Federation to give some of these Chinese businessmen that want to show off? Can we give them something so that they don't end up, and this is my fear, end up as people have more money and are going, more and more Chinese are going to Africa, that they will want to join those trophy hunting teams and bring back a trophy? And as I heard from Brent the other day, the worst thing in the world about the trophy is that you're killing the most vital, the most important animal in the family. It's the biggest, the stronger, it's the head of the herd.
it's like a joke when they go over, but they have everybody and they're banging and so they kind of bring the animal right to you, so it's not even a hunting expedition.
Yeah, well, I don't think, and I've been reading things about in Vietnam where they're sending in prostitutes to get the permits, because you're only allowed so many, so you need different people to go in for the rhino. So it is really like a fear that things are going to move more in that direction. So I think it's really important to find something tangible. We need to find ways that people can spend money, look heroic, great, manly, incredible, and it not be in conflict with an endangered wildlife product. In fact, it has nothing, you know, it has to be something else. So I think that's what it's calling for, is really creative thinking. I mean, one of my I have a whole list of campaigns, but one of them is I'm going to get on Apple and Microsoft. I want them to make an ad for their phones that is educational about taking selfies with animals. I really think that it's in their best interest to do that. And they're all claiming that they're doing all this stuff for the wild. So, but I guess feel like creativity is the answer, and that's also culture. And you know, it's arts, it's education, it's all those things. But if you can create, and there's a humane education movement going on in China in some pockets. There are people, because of the pesticides and all the pollution, that are all starting to want to grow their own and know what's happening with it. There is some of that happening. As well as here, there are pockets. I just feel like after a while, I'm not talking strictly about the Chinese in China per se. I'm talking about it in a broader sense. We all travel back and forth. So, any ideas?
Well, I have a feeling really there's just too many people on the planet.
Well, that is one, absolutely. But, okay.
And maybe we can honor.
They've already cut.
We can do honor to those people who do not have children. You know, I mean, because it's too much that needs, that humans have too much to sustain a way of life that.
Well, we could talk about that after. Yeah, sure.
All right, thank you.
Excuse me.